What I'd like to do is to put some of the ideas that we talked about this morning, that I talked about, in try and get us to put them into practice. Basically expand on them a little bit. And I have three chapters in this afternoon's presentation. We're going to talk again about a little bit about the what. I want to pull out that thing about setting direction, human development, and organizational development. I want to talk a lot about the how, and in particular about how the situation matters, and how we might think about situation as organizational or infrastructure, and how we might redesign our infrastructures to support the production of new knowledge in our schools and school systems. And then I'm going to be, again, finished with, like I did this morning, with the challenges. What are the difficulties involved in doing this work from a distributed perspective, from the perspective here at this session, from the perspective of the school principal or the lead teacher? So let's spend a little time on the what of leading and managing human development practice. And as I said this morning, we know from research that there are three key sets of things that good organizational leaders do. They address direction. Where are we going as a school, as a preschool? Second, they address the human development issue. And here I'm not talking about the human development of children. That's obvious. I'm talking about the human development of your staff, including leaders, teachers, paraprofessionals, and so on. That is really, and we could include parents here because they're a key stakeholder with us. Remember, the most important resource we have in teaching is the teachers. That's the most important resource we have. It's also more than likely the most costly resource we have, although I suspect that in Singapore, the cost of space can be quite high. And then, of course, the organizational development part. So let me try and pull these apart. By the way, I'm going to talk a little bit in the beginning, but we're going to do a lot of activities, including we're going to watch that video again and let you guys this time pull it apart as a group, rather than me telling you what I saw, when you may see other things. Setting direction. It's about building a vision for teaching and learning. What is our vision for teaching and learning? What are our aims for learning? What is it we want kids to know and be able to do? And how do we think, what's the vision for how we're going to get there? Are we using project method? Are we using thematic method? What's our kind of approach to getting kids to develop, to grow socio-emotionally, cognitively, etc.? It's one thing to have a vision. As you all know, you can have great visions. You've seen organizations with these great visions on paper, right? And you go in and everybody kind of say, well, what are you talking about? You know, people in the organization, oh, I never heard about it. Ah, yeah, that's just, right? You have to get people to buy into this vision. And we do this as school leaders in several ways. One way in which we do it, and this came out in the schools we visited the other day, is we do it when we hire new teachers. We don't just hire a great teacher. We ask ourselves, does this teacher fit the philosophy of teaching and learning that we have at this school, right? That's very, very, we do not want somebody who does not, sometimes we might hire somebody who doesn't maybe embrace the philosophy, but we can see that that person's willing and open to do so. When we move in a new direction, we have to get buy-in again. In many respects, that's why we involve teachers, that's why we have teacher leaders involved in the process of leading and managing our preschools. If we want to make these visions a reality on the ground, we have to have some goals. Sorry, this is going to happen all afternoon, but wants me to connect to the internet for some reason. But we want to establish goals that will help us realize. What are our goals for this school year? I can't remember which of the schools we visited, but one talked about having a curriculum review every 6 months and then deciding, oh, where are we going? Are we on the right direction? Are we getting there? And finally, I cannot stress enough, and this may not be a big issue in Singapore, but you tell me if it is, but certainly in the United States, I see it in the UK, expectations. It is music additional side effects here. If we've known this for 50, 60, 70 years, a famous study, Pygmalion in the Classroom, about how teachers' expectations, if you don't think certain kids can learn, those kids will not learn. You can be the best teacher in the world, but if you think that poor kids cannot achieve, cannot develop like their counterparts who come from higher socioeconomic backgrounds, those poor kids are not going to thrive in your classroom. Expectations are critical. It's very funny, one of the schools that we studied in Chicago, this is a primary school, not a preschool, and the principal, African-American woman, 99% African-American, predominantly African-American staff. Most of the kids, I'd say 95% of the kids on free and reduced lunch, which is they live below the poverty line. Her biggest challenge when she took over that school was changing teachers' expectations for the students. She used to have a mantra. She used to say, you know, the parents are sending us the best kids they have. They're not keeping the good ones at home. We have to work with these children. And that's the challenge. So when I talk about setting direction, this is how I flesh it out. The second part is the human development. And the human development component involves, as you all know, supervising and monitoring teaching and learning. Sorry, I need my note here from this morning, but maybe I mislaid it. Monitoring the implementation of programs and new approaches. Developing teachers and the staff, as I talked about this morning. And this development, as became clear in the schools we visited, this development can happen through external professional development, external courses. But I think in education, and I think in maybe the preschool, early childhood sector in particular, we do not fully appreciate the opportunities for learning on the job, the opportunities for learning in-house, in our own schools, from one another, and indeed by building ties, by creating networks to other schools. One of my colleagues, who's an economist, did a recent study, and I'm not going to tell you the details of the study, but it's a very strong causal account. He estimates, based on work in the US, that 20% of the improvement in teachers' productivity can be accounted for by the peers they interact with. In other words, they're learning on the job. Now, we've known this for a while, but we have not had the solid causal evidence to support it. Think about 20% of the improvement comes from interaction with peers. By the way, one thing I should say, I should have said this at the beginning, it is more than okay to interrupt me, to ask a question, to clarify it, to say, oh, I think that's all wrong, or you know, anything you want to say. So please do interrupt as we go. And of course, providing encouragement and recognition. you know, we recognize kids all the time. They're great work, doing very well, growth, improvement, right? But often we forget to recognize our staff, people who do something amazing, right? And sometimes, of course, as staff, we don't want to be singled out. I get embarrassed if the dean at a faculty meeting says, oh, we need to recognize Jim for, stop, right? But it's important that we recognize our achievements. It's important that we recognize the successes of our staff. Here we go again, but this is okay. I guess if I turned off the Wi-Fi, I would solve that problem. Okay, that's the human development component. I think it's pretty straightforward. And this is the organizational development component. We as school leaders, whether we're teacher leaders, principal, right? We don't just develop the human beings in our organization, our staff, our parents. We also have to work on the development of our organizational arrangements, building relations among staff. Building connections beyond the schoolhouse. In other words, how do we connect with another school? At lunch, somebody was talking about taking some of their teachers to Taiwan to see other schools, right? But also the local connections that we can have. Getting resources, handling any disturbances, deprivatizing classroom practice. To me, this is critical. Somebody brought up to me after my talk this morning also about deprivatizing leadership practice. And I said, that's a brilliant idea. Because too often leadership is kind of a mystery. It's what the principal does, right? How do we make it more public? If you remember in the video clip this morning, which you're going to see again, but that's fine, right? Remember in the video clip, Jean tells the space, Jim and the space shuttle, shut down reactive valve, whatever, right? And there was silence. And Jean said, ask them, did they copy that? And then he said, very importantly, he said, tell them that's the only way we think we can stop the leak. How often as leaders do we just say, there, you cannot do this anymore, or you need to do this, rather than making transparent, well, the reason is, it completely changes how people might react. It also helps people to get inside. Oh, I know now. That makes perfect sense. The transparency is really critical. Deprivatizing practice is not easy. Maybe peer observation is not the easiest thing to start with. But what about, as we talked about in the discussion this morning, what about if you just during your level meetings, or sometimes some people have level meetings, others have meetings that cut across levels, right? What about if you started by having teachers share examples of kids' work around a particular area? And you'd say, look, I'm going to ask every teacher in, let's say we're doing K-1, right? When we meet at our level meeting on this Friday, right? Everybody is to bring a piece of work that has to do with a particular goal or a particular part of the curriculum, right? And you say, bring a piece that you think is amazing. Bring a piece that you think is not bad, you know, there's, and a piece that you think is weak and you're wondering how, and then let's discuss what's going on here. What do we think the issues are? Are the video clubs I talked about this morning. And by the way, any of these ideas, please feel free to ask me if you want to know more about them. Building trust among staff and stakeholders, critical. Research for the last 10 or 15 years, over and over again, shows the power of trust. If teachers don't trust one another, they're not going to share. They're not going to open up. If I'm struggling with getting my kids to learn the concept of number, or if I'm struggling to get them at the concept of print, right? Unless I trust my colleagues. I'm not going to say that. Next thing, the principal will know. Next thing, I might be without a job. Trust is fundamental to learning. That goes for learning with kids, too. You all know this. If the kids don't trust you, your chances of getting them to learn and develop is limited. And as I talked at the end of my talk this morning, collective responsibility. Again, the wonderful example from Collective O, I'm sorry, I keep harping on this. The notion that there is, that nobody has a classroom. Everything belongs to everybody. Think about what kind of a culture, what kind of norms that creates. This is not a situation of this is my space and that's yours. This is our space. Again, collective responsibility has been shown to be associated with, and now I'm going to really turn this thing off if I can. Collective responsibility has been shown to associated with improvement in school productivity. Schools with higher collective responsibility have been shown to improve student achievement much more than schools that lack it. Okay, that's enough for now on the what. Let's talk about the how of leading and managing human development. Oh, any questions? By the way, I'm going to, Angela has a PDF of this morning's PowerPoint and this PowerPoint, and that PDF will go online. I think, Angela, I'm not telling a lie here. In fact, I'm pretty sure I'm right. It'll go online and you can all just download it too. Just so you know. One of the problems I think we have in the educational sector is that we have a implementation mentality. I'll take a read of this, look a little closely here. Caveman, Stone Age, and we still had that situation where we had all those experts, consultants out there telling us what to do. But we, of course, only had one hunter and one gatherer to do the work. Now, there are lots of good ideas out there, right? There's some bad ones, too. Be careful, right? And there are lots of ideas out there that have never been proven or tested for anything, right? But my point here is simpler. My point is that it is not enough to rely on programs and ideas that are out there. You have to get beyond just simply implementing other people's ideas. Yes, take other people's ideas. Again, at Collective O, they talked about taking the tray idea, right? But adapting it. That's not just about implementation. That's about taking something, adapting it, redesigning it to fit in my particular situation. What I want to argue with you, actually, is that as school leaders, as teachers, we need to, in addition to just implementing stuff, we need to adopt a diagnostic and a design mindset. You do this as teachers all the time, right? You say, oh, this K-1 student, there's something going on here. It's really struggling with this particular skill. You say, I wonder what's happening. Maybe I should ask some of my colleagues if they have any ideas. Maybe I should talk to the parents. Diagnostic work. The same thing goes for our work as leaders. We do it all the time. We're losing a lot of teachers. Our teachers are not talking to one another. Or there's low morale. We say, why? What's happening? Diagnostic work is at the very core of what leading and managing preschools is all about. Kids are coming late to school. Why? What's going on? What might be the reasons for this? Diagnostic, of course, is simply identifying the nature or cause of something. Doctors do it all the time. You know, you go with an ache. Right? They take the temperature. They listen to your heart. say, oh, I think it might be this, but then again, it could be this, so let's do some blood. We do the same thing as organizational leaders. We say, oh, I'm noticing this pattern. What might be going on here? Here's one possible explanation. By the way, one thing I want you to really take away from this is that some people think that data tells us what the problem is. Right? How many times have you heard people say, the data said? Politicians do this all the time. I don't know about Singaporean politicians, but American politicians do this all the time. Oh, the data said this. Now, I've been a researcher for something like, I don't know, 22, 23 years. Data has never spoken to me yet. Even after two glasses of wine, it still does not speak. Data does not speak. Whether it's test data, whether it's attendance data. We need to get away from that. You know, the notion that there are problems lying under the carpet in our buildings or under the floor and we just have to dig them up to find them. No, problems are social definitions. We define problems. And hopefully, in doing so, we use data in the process. So, and if you don't believe me, please watch CNN some evening and see two, a Republican and a Democrat politician in the United States defining the problem in completely different ways using the same data, right? So think about problem definition not as this purely technical number crunching or, right? It's a social construction based on data, we hope. Now, we can do all the diagnostic work in the world. I'll start moving around in a bit, but let me get through the first part here. We can do all the diagnostic work in the world, but if we don't do something with it, we're wasting our time. So this is the second thing we have to we're designers. We shape the organization and the system infrastructure, and I'll tell you in a minute what I mean by infrastructure, to match, to attain, to reach certain purposes. Now, you think that, you think that design is a kind of a very grandiose activity, you know, the Diors, the Calvin Kleins, the Calatravas, right? Architects, fashion designers. Design is an everyday activity. We all do design. And design is at the very core of leading and managing the preschool. So we need to not just think of ourselves as implementers. Yes, we implement some things. Maybe we've taken a whole course on the project method. We're going to implement that. Good. But a lot of what we have to do is also about diagnosis and design, and we should embrace it. The unfortunate thing is that school principal, school leader preparation programs prepares people as implementers. I'm not talking about Singapore, I don't know. I'm talking about the US. It does not prepare people to be designers. I think actually everybody should more than likely take an engineering course. I'm not joking. We could learn a lot. Engineers think about design. And not just, they don't just think about bridges and buildings. They think about social design too. Okay, so what are we designing? Let's talk a little bit about this educational infrastructure. It's kind of shocking to see on my computer screen 1:13 a.m., but of course it's on American time, but I got a little shocked there for a second. We're designing what I'm beginning to talk about as school system and school organizational infrastructure. Here, I mean things like, these are the resources and structures that frame and focus our work in organizations. Here I mean things like the educational infrastructure. In other words, the curriculum, the tools we use, the technology, the books, the activities, the trays, right? All of those things that we use in the classroom every day with kids. That's part of it. The other part is the formal organizational structure, the positions. I think it was Pushpa was talking about teacher leaders, right? That's a position. I think she had level leaders. That's a position. When we talk about the formal organizational infrastructure, we also talk about the organizational routines, like level meetings. That's a routine. Something that happens regularly, that involves two or more members of the organization. I'm sure in a little bit when we start talking, you can list routines for me. Peer tutoring, video club could be a routine, lesson study could be a routine. These things are very, very important because they structure, they frame, they focus how we do our work. And then, of course, the social infrastructure, the people and their capability, teachers, school leaders. This is what I mean by infrastructure. I'm going to come back to this in a second, but you're going to leave me go here for a sec. When we, when I think about infrastructure here, I'm focusing on this part of the triangle. I could go on about the leaders, I could go on about the followers, but if you take, from this session, if you take one key message from me, it's situation matters, and we need to adopt a diagnostic and design mindset towards it. Ignore that for a second. And that's what I mean by infrastructure. In other words, what I'm trying to do is I'm trying to take this very broad notion of situation and I'm trying to make it more tangible when I use the word infrastructure. Infrastructure is very important in our private lives, by the way. The infrastructure in our homes means that when you got up this morning, when I got up this morning at 6 a.m., I hopped in the shower at the hotel, I flipped the, do you say tap, right? Yeah. The Americans say faucet. It is 26 years and I'm still finding it a struggle. And the hot water came out, right? I flipped the light switch and I didn't think about what was going on behind the walls, right? No, that's the infrastructure. It's invisible, yet it's near at hand. It's just there. The same thing about the infrastructure in our neighborhoods. Some of you drove, more than likely. Others of you hopped on the MRT. You didn't wonder about, oh, I wonder how this thing works, right? Or I wonder how these roads were designed. You just take them for granted. The only time we worry about infrastructure is when it does not work. When I hop in the shower in Chicago on a cold January morning, and oh, no hot water, just cold water. I said, God, what's going on here, right? Now, this is just physical infrastructure, so I'm using it as a metaphor because I want you to think about infrastructure much more broadly. When I think about organizational infrastructure, when I think about organizational preschool organizational infrastructure, I think about this. It has things like policies. It has the regulations and rules we have. It has the organizational routines. Yes, it has the physical layout of the building too. But it's much more complicated because it's not just physical, it's also social. And I put it up here like this not because I want you to have eye problems from trying to figure it out. I put it up here like this to stress what I just said. Infrastructure is invisible. When you go to school on Monday, you're not going to say, it's a Monday. What's the script today? Oh, what routine are we going? No, you just do it. Infrastructure is invisible, yet it's there. It fundamentally shapes how we do our work. Yet, we are the ones that create the infrastructure. Okay, what I'm going to do in a few minutes is I'm going to pull out one or two examples of this, and we're going to talk about, I'm going to share with you some work that we've done around them, and I want to show you how organizational routines and positions work together to frame the interactions in our organizations. But before we do that, let me do a little activity. Let's go back to this from this morning. Everybody participated this morning. Indulge me, and let's watch the video clip again. I'm going to cut it off a little bit earlier because you know how it ended. I was going to cut it off earlier this morning, but then I said everybody's going to be worried. What happened? How many of you have seen the movie before, by the way? Some of you are too young. It was more than likely it came out after you were born. But anyway. So again, the activity is, where's the leadership here? I want you to think about the interactions. I want you to think about the infrastructure. And then rather than me go on about it, I'm going to let you take 4 or 5 minutes in your groups to discuss leadership as it was captured in this Hollywood clip. Clear? Makes sense? Now, just close your ears for one moment as I... And let's hope this works. If it doesn't, we have a problem. Okay. Sorry, I'm going to just check one thing on my computer. Let's do a different activity for a second. I'm going to show you for now, and then we'll try and do this again later. It doesn't matter when we do it, actually. This activity is to put your mathematical skills to the test. Some of you may have seen this activity. It's called Sustained Silent Movie Watching. Let's go to a different activity. I'm going to show you a video clip. If you've done this, please don't.
There are two teams. One is wearing white sweatshirts, and the other wearing black sweatshirts. How many of you have done it? Two people are nodding over there. Okay. The question is this, and I need complete silence. Nothing. Not a word. Not a pen drop. It's sleep time. It is, right? It's about time we have sleep, right? Okay, not a word. How many times does the white team pass the ball? Please do not interrupt me or talk to your neighbor about what does he mean by pass the ball? How many times does the white team, these are the ones with the white sweatshirt, pass the ball? And make sure you write down your answer at the end, and then we'll go around and figure out who got it right and who got it wrong. There's no right or wrong answer, but I want to see how you... So it's a little bit of a mathematical task. Are we all ready? Okay, here we go. Okay, just before we do anything, silent. Who have participated in this activity before? What? Surprising. I do this all over the world and increasingly. There is at least four or five people in the audience who have done it. Okay. How many times does the white team pass the ball? 14. Anybody have more than 14? 15. Okay, 14, 15. I'm reminded that I promised the cameraman I would use the mic, so here we go. Who had 10 to 14? Not 14, but less than 14. So 10, yeah. How many? 13. Who had less than 10? What did the rest of you have? 11. Oh, okay. Anything else about the video? I can't hear you. 18. Eight. Anybody else aside from how many times the white team passed the ball, did anybody else have any observation to make about the video?
There's a gorilla.
There's a what?
Gorilla.
How many people saw a gorilla?
A figure in black.
So how many people did not see a gorilla? It's okay. You're not supposed to see it. So let us play the video again, okay? Forget about my question. Just watch the video. Keep watching, because he's not hiding. Now, I do this, by the way, this is a very common phenomenon that you don't see the gorilla. There are lots of these videos online, different ones. But the reason I do it is very, very particular. The framework I gave you about the white team focused you on a very particular slice of what was going on, so that half of you, or maybe more, did not see the gorilla. Because of the frame I gave to the task. And I'm putting this out there because this morning I argued about taking a distributed perspective, right? A distributed framework, rather than a heroics of leader framework, right? And the importance of that is because depending on the framework we take, we will see some things and we will not see other things. It is very important that we are explicit about what's the framework we have. We all have frameworks, by the way. Anybody who says, oh, I'm a blank slate, laugh, because nobody's a blank slate. We may not be explicit about the framework, but we all have frameworks. We can't live without them. Life would be too complicated. They're tacit, typically. But what I'm saying is,
let's try and be explicit as a team. What's our framework for leadership, for teaching, right? Because otherwise, we won't know when we don't see the gorilla or the elephant in the room. At least if we know what our framework is, we know what it foregrounds and we know what it backgrounds. Okay, we'll come back to the other video in a little bit. Let us move back to infrastructure. Routines are critical, and I need a little bit of help here. 1 minute each table. Can you identify, just nominate one organizational routine from your preschool that you think is critical for improving teaching practice in your school? Anyone. It can be any school. But take it as a team, take a minute and discuss and identify one. And I'm going to ask you to share out. I'm sorry. My voice is, you know, I need a little break, so time for you guys to work a little bit. So one routine from each table. Just pick one, and you're going to tell us in a couple of sentences what it is and why you think it's so great. Now, if you don't, if you're still wondering about what these routines are, ask me, and I'll tell, and I'll say some more. Can we come back together? Yeah? Do we have nominations from each table? Yes, great. Everybody ready for a little sharing out? I'm going to, we're going to share a mic here. We're going to give this one. Hello. Okay, so we're going to listen, we're going to have a, everybody's going to get a chance here to share one routine. Just want to make sure everybody's on the same page. Yep.
One of the common routines in our centers is, whether we do it well or not, is the documentation of learning and how that is applied to improve teaching subsequently.
So tell us a little bit about how the documentation of learning happens. A couple of sentences.
Taking notes down on what a particular child might need as a follow-up, taking pictures, gathering evidences to show parents that progress has taken place.
Okay, good. Note, routine, structure. Anybody at this learning center could say, oh, this is documentation of learning. Next, who wants to go next? Always good to go early because you can't repeat a routine. So you might run out of options and then you're in serious trouble. Anybody? No? Yes, thank you. And then I'm coming here because they volunteered.
Yeah, like for us, we do the team meetings within the levels.
So each level has a team meeting?
That's right, even though we only have two classes.
Okay.
Level. But they do this. They do meet not only with the teachers, but with the assistant teachers as well. And they discuss on curriculum for the term, they discuss about classroom management, and if they have any problems within themselves. So they discuss about that.
And how often do you have team meetings?
At least once a month.
Okay, so team meetings at each level. And they happen once a month, focused on instruction, focused on teaching and learning. Okay, you guys have volunteered, so.
Ditto, all right, it's the same, you know.
What is it?
I mean, it's the same, ditto as them. We have a monthly meeting once a month. And from what they have already discussed, yes, we have that. But the other thing is that because it's very operational, so that we take the platform so that the new teachers or those who have not been exposed to certain hairy situations, like say with parents and things like that, we learn from there, we move on from there.
So here is a routine that is designed to let novices, new teachers, learn from the more experienced teachers through the sharing of information, ideas. I like you said scary situations, was there a hairy situation?
Hairy.
I knew what that meant. Okay, who's next? Oh, here we go, yes.
Actually with mine, I learned from experience because in my school, we have Wednesday and Friday assemblies. So what happens is one teacher will be in charge of telling stories or singing songs with the children other than their class. So the whole school is there. So what happens is, with that, when I was new, I see their strategies, I see how they move and how they are able to cure the children's attention. So I learned a lot from it and I practice it every time that I get appointed.
Great. Now, very important here. I mean, we take assemblies for granted. Right? Oh, it's just an assembly. But this is powerful. This is assemblies, as you pointed out beautifully. Assemblies allow practice to be deprivatized, made public, made explicit, so that new teachers can learn strategies, can learn how to do things that the veterans have down. And very often, by the way, a lot of the knowledge that veteran teachers have is tacit, right? You all know this. You have a brilliant K-2 teacher, right? She's just amazing, off the charts. And you go to her room and you say, well, just tell me how you do it. She says, I don't know, I just do it, right? That's because the knowledge is tacit. It's very hard to make explicit. But when, as in this beautiful example, when you have assemblies or other sorts of routines that new teachers can see this expert practice, they begin to notice things. Socialization, really, really critical. Guys are not getting off the hook. And there's one more group over here who's going, I don't know what they're going to come up with, but we'll see.
Okay. In the implementations of events in the center, so we will have a meeting with the staff, discuss the item that we want to implement the event, and talk about the problem that is going to surface, and talk about the previous problem that parents give survey on. For example, the safety issue, the many things that parents have given you feedback. Take note of that. And after that, work on those areas that you want to improve, and the number, everything in terms of numbers of students, parents. So from there, teachers, because it's an open discussion, teachers are allowed to input all their ideas. So we work on the midpoint as whether what can be done, what can be done, and after that, finalize and run meetings after meetings, maybe two or three meetings, so that everybody has a clear understanding. Let me cite an example. We did a lantern festival, making mooncake. So many of my teachers are foreigners. They don't know how to make the mooncake. So we have two rounds of demonstration for the teachers, and the teachers actually practice again and again. So on the actual day, they are very good with it. I don't even have to step in to tell them anymore. And they present it just like that. They did it well, and in terms of safety, it actually covers it. So at the end, we have a survey, and the survey came back from the school.
Great. That's wonderful. So let me just comment on the first one, because I think it's wonderful. This opportunity as a staff to get together, to identify, define problems, right? And think about, not only has everybody got input, that also gets buy-in. It gives people a sense of ownership. This is our definition of the problem. Not that the principal is saying, this is the problem, you go work on. Again, ownership, sense of ownership being key. Last group, last but not least. Don't be shy.
I think we mentioned something about observation, classroom observations, and like the teachers actually have, they carry out their lessons while we also, the center leaders do go in and give some ideas. At the same time, we also get people from the same level and from another class to watch what they're doing as well.
Observation, peer observation, can be very powerful. Lots of different routines out there, by the way, that you can learn about, like instructional rounds, big idea in the US. Richard Elmore at Harvard has developed. Teachers, groups of teachers go to visit classrooms. Learning walks or walkthroughs, examples of this. Video club is a way also of observing other people's practice without actually being in the room. Thank you. That's powerful. Because what I want to try and argue with you is that these things are really, really important. And they can be designed in ways that make teaching public, that develop trust among staff, that allow us to engage as a staff in that critical, constructive dialogue I talked about. In other words, these things don't just happen naturally. We design them, we deploy them, we monitor them to make sure they're working well. When they're not working well, but for example, if in this example, right, all the teachers were doing were observing one another, but oh, that means I have 15 minutes just to sit in the back of my colleague's classroom and take a little break, right? We say, oh, there's something wrong here. This is not why we designed this routine. Why is this happening? What do we need to do so that the routine is generative, so that teachers learn from it, rather than just taking a 15-minute break when they're sitting in the back of somebody else's classroom? Very, very good. I'm very conscious of our technology guy's time, so we're actually going to jump back again. We'll come back to routines, don't worry. And we're going to watch this little video clip once more. Just wants to jump. So you all saw a version of it this morning, so now we're just going to re-watch it, and then we're going to discuss as a group.
Something out in the space.
I can see it outside window one right now. Definitely a gas of some sort.
It's gotta be the oxygen.
Roger, obviously we copy your vision.
Give me a lamp.
Okay, let's have a question.
Okay, let's start right now.
Is that a matrix?
What have we got on the spacecraft that's good? I'll get back to you, Jane.
We're not going to have power much longer. Ship's bleeding to death.
Given what I said about distributed leadership this morning, leader plus this practice aspect, tell me one lesson from one thing that is captured, illuminated from this clip that you think is very important. Anything. Fair? Just one. Each table has to come up with one. And I suspect that this time round, everybody will be volunteering to go first because you don't. Oh, and by the way, I don't want to. You don't want to repeat anything. Well, of course, you've forgotten what I said this morning, anyway. But anyway, about the video. But one key lesson about leadership from a distributed perspective from this. I'd like you actually to take a couple of minutes at your table, and you volunteer. Good. Okay. The table one is over here. Smart. I shouldn't be giving you the strategies. So, 2 or 3 minutes as a group. Take about 1 minute to finish up, kind of get our main ideas here. I'm actually only going to take 3 people to report out because I'm worried about the time. So we have 1, 2, and we'll take 1 more volunteer, otherwise I'll just pick one group. You know. That's like what you do, right? After your 30 seconds wait time and nobody's volunteering to answer and you just say, okay, why don't you do it? Okay, are we ready?
Yes.
Okay, let's hear from this group, then we come over here and maybe one other group. Just, you know, something that really hits you guys as a group as you talk.
So what this table has discussed was that we noticed that the leader, he wasn't sure initially what he needed to do, but one of his subordinates stepped up to it and he said that from my position, this is what that needed to be done. And so he also took in the environment, everyone else, their body language, how they reacted, and then he felt that, okay, I need to trust my staff, and so I'm going forward with that decision, and I will carry it on.
Very, very good. So one thing here, Gene is the positional leader, but he thought about it, and he says, Sai has the expertise, and then Sai rose to the occasion. He said, from my chair here, right? Very powerful. It's not because I'm the boss, it's because from my chair, from my expertise, from the data, this is what's important. By the way, one thing in our organizations that's really important, it's really critical, is do we create organizational cultures where people who are not in formal leadership positions feel comfortable, feel confident to express their views? Sai did. But very often in organizations, or not only that, he had the courage, the conviction to stick with it. Because remember Gene's reaction, he said, what do you mean? What do you mean? Most people would just say, oh no, no, it's fine, principal, forget what I said, right? We don't want those cultures. And we as leaders need to create those cultures where, yes, we challenge somebody when they say something, but we want them to say, no, hang on, I'm not backing down here. I'm pretty confident about that. The courage of followers is also critical. And we'll take this view.
Sorry.
Actually, you only say everything but we wanted to say.
Good.
But
it caught me at my own tricks.
But to add on, I think the thing that leaps out is that culture of speaking up, because there was already a culture of communication and trust, and the leader did not let the ego get into his way. And I think he was receptive, right? And consultative in a way, but in the end, he did make the decision for the greater good.
Yeah. Really, really good. Taking the ego out of leadership. It's so difficult to do at times. Because we feel when somebody like Sai steps up and defines a problem, oh, well, maybe he's after my job, what are we going to do, right? So you could have my job. When I was department chair for 3 years, I said, oh, you want it? Take it. Right? But no, we have to take the ego out. This is what I was talking about this morning, too, when I talked about knowing our strengths, knowing our weaknesses, not being afraid to say, you know what? That's not my area, but I have a Sai, or I have somebody over here, and I know that person knows this area. He or she has the expertise, and I trust them. That's what's key. Okay, I'm very worried about time because, I was having fun, and I just realized we've only about 25 minutes. But anyway, let us return to organizational routines. And these are the things that we need. They're staples, right? Routines, organizations cannot survive without them. They allow efficient, coordinated action. They reduce conflict about how to do the work. They are a source of continuity when we lose staff. It's amazing how some schools can lose 50% of their staff, yet next year, well, yes, things are different, but in many respects, things are very similar. And of course, they also have disadvantages. You know, we can go through the routine, right? Go to a faculty meeting or assembly and I just do it without really participating. We need to watch for that. Routines are everywhere. They're key, and they're a critical part of this thing I'm calling infrastructure. Why are they so important? They're important because they're critical when it comes to social capital development and building teacher capability. One of the things that I have been arguing about is that in the education sector, and I think this is true of the preschool sector also, we are still relying on last century notions about capability. You might use the word capacity, but I don't like the word capacity because rooms have capacity, people have capability. It's a big distinction. We think about, as I said this morning, we think about capability in terms of the individual, the human capital, the skill, the motivation of an individual, the expertise that's inside the head. That's important. It's a big notion last century. World Bank, OECD, everybody talks about human capital. Towards the end of the last century, also, another idea began to emerge from the work of an American sociologist called James Coleman and a French sociologist called Pierre Bourdieu. They talked about social capital. And when they talked about social capital, they basically talked about capability that resides not inside the head of an individual, or if you want, that's embodied by an individual, but capability that resides in the relationships among people. By the way, societies have been doing this for hundreds and hundreds of years. They come together to solve particular tasks. When I was a kid growing up on the southwest coast of Ireland, all the neighbors would come to go to each farm to trash the corn, because one farmer couldn't do it on his or her own. So the neighbors would come to help, but then everybody would... This is what I mean by social capital. It, in part, has to do with the fact that I don't know something, but I know Angela, and I have a tie to Angela, so I can go to Angela and ask her, help me with this. That's one part of it. But the other part of it is that... Are we okay? The other part of it is... that's critical, is that when we connect with other people, when we interact with them, and when we pool our expertise, we can gain new insights. We can build new knowledge by putting our knowledge, individual knowledge, together. Make sense? Thank you very much. Appreciate it. This is the power of social capital. So in this new century, I think, yes, we'll continue to worry about human capital, but I think social capital is the thing we really need to think about, invest in, and figure out how to develop. Social resources are a source of many things: ideas, trust, incentives. They can enable the transfer of advice and information. Some people think, by the way, that I can... some people say, give me the knowledge. I can't give you knowledge. Knowledge is something, it's know-how. It's something you have to develop. It's like teachers cannot learn for kids. Kids have to do the learning. You can teach them, but you cannot learn for them. So I don't think you can give people knowledge. I can give you information, I can give you advice, and then maybe, not always, we all know this, we're all teachers. Sometimes you'll develop new knowledge based on that, other times you won't. But what's critical is the giving of the advice, the exchange of advice, the exchange of information, the exchange of ideas. And this is why in schools and organizations, I am putting such an emphasis on interactions about teaching and learning. In my work, by the way, we can think of, this is from an author called Cho, we can think about knowledge, he talks about knowledge transfer, I don't like that. But we can think about how knowledge gets produced through making tacit knowledge, for example, explicit. It's like your beautiful example down here about the assemblies and learning from observing the veteran teachers. What about if we could have a novice or young, or any teacher, watch a veteran teacher, or somebody who's an expert in something, right? And say, oh, I see what you're doing, and the veteran says, well, you know, I never thought of it, but you're more than likely right. You're helping make that tacit knowledge explicit so that others can learn from it. Let us capture, build on the resources within, because we have some amazing resources, yet because our social capital is not well developed, I don't think we're maximizing their use. So what my colleagues and I do in schools is we look at interaction patterns among teachers about particular aspects of their work. And this is an example, I'm not going to let you do this. Well, this is an example of a school, and it's the map network in the school. Basically, what we did is we gave teachers a survey where we asked them, who do you go to for advice and information about mathematics, teaching, learning, curriculum? And they listed the people they went to. And then using that data, we drew a map of the flow of advice and information within the school. I intentionally put it up there like that because you're all wondering what's going on here. Just so you know, person A told us, let me look at it over here, it'll be easier. Person A told us they went to person C for advice, look at the direction of the arrow. And person C told us they went to person A, hence it's a two-way relationship. Person A told us they went to person B, but person B did not tell us they went to person A. And what you see here, there's a math coach in the center who's very, a lot of people going to her. You also see lots of interactions by level, which is, I think, something that you'd more than likely see in a lot of your schools also, that K1 teachers are more likely to talk to one another, K2 teachers are more likely to talk to one another. This is critical because in our work over, and I'm not going to go into the details of the studies here, in our work over and over again, we find that the infrastructure fundamentally shapes who teachers talk to about their work. Yes, there's an effect of individual characteristics. Teachers of the same gender are more likely to talk to one another. I'm sure in preschool, given that 90% or more are female, that will skew that a little bit. Teachers of the same race are more likely to talk to one another. This may be an American phenomenon, I don't know. It's significant, but it's small. But the big story is that the level matters. Teachers teaching the same level are more likely to teach, are more likely to talk to one another. Why? Physical location, maybe, partly. Why? The routines they participate in, like level meetings that we saw in one of our school visits on Wednesday, right? And people with formal leadership positions, could be principal, it could be mathematics coach, it could be teacher leader, and you have teacher leaders, level leaders, for example, at one of the other schools we were in on, these people make a difference. Other people go to them for advice and information. In other words, what I'm saying to you, be careful who you put in these positions. Make sure the people you put in them are the people you want giving advice and information to other teachers. I'm sure you do, but it's really key. In all of this work, we have been struck by how we can redesign the infrastructure to shape the interaction patterns. This morning I talked a little bit about strong ties and their importance. They're especially important for the transfer of tacit, complex knowledge. The sort of knowledge that's at the very core of teaching, whether it's preschool, kindergarten, or primary. Teaching, a lot of teaching, is tacit knowledge. Weak ties are fine for the transfer of explicit information, right? The ties that span the boundaries, very critical. And of course, the trust is critical. Now, I don't have enough time to go in detail. I think we have about 10 minutes, Angela? Am I? Yeah, 10 minutes. Yeah. In one of our, I'm going to try and do this very quickly. In one of these studies, and some of the people that were at the Wednesday session, some of the fellows heard me talk about this. In one of our studies, we followed a whole system, 15 schools, in one local education authority or school district, and we looked at their efforts to redesign their infrastructure. introduced a new curriculum around mathematics, an inquiry-based approach to teaching math. If anybody knows about investigations math, all around activities, very strong focus on not only learning the procedures and definitions, but also learning the concepts. You know, a balance between principled and procedural knowledge. And then they built, they created a training program for teacher leaders, one per school, strategically picked. I want to do that. No. The principal and the curriculum director from the system decided who got to do it. And then they said, oh, this would be a great person. Let's go talk and see if this person will do it. And they went off and did a master's in mathematics and mathematics teaching, paid for by the system, right? And then some of them came back as coaches, others came back as teacher leaders. In other words, they were still full-time teachers, but they had a new position of teacher leader on the side, like the two hats that Pushpa was talking about, right? You have the teaching hat and you have the leader hat. And then they created a whole set of routines, professional learning communities organized by level, system-wide routines where lead teachers from each building got together once a month. Maybe the lead math teachers got together, only one per school. There was a lead teacher for English language arts. They got together once a month at the system level. This is what I mean by infrastructure, right? You're building an infrastructure to support a particular vision, in this case for mathematics. And what my colleagues and I have been studying is, well, so what? Did things change? And I'm going to give you two cases and then I'm going to summarize. This is one of the teacher leaders the year before he, John is his name, before he became a, before he went off for this program, right? And as you can see, John is pretty central, right? He has quite a number of people going to him already for advice and information about math. But what happens with time is that John becomes more central, see? And then even more central still. John becomes a key giver of advice and information about mathematics in his building. You also begin to see the buildup of triadic relations. Not just dyadic, but triadic. Triadic relations are very important, right? I want to get Angela to do something for me, right? And I say, Angela, please do this. I need your help, blah, blah. And she says, yeah, no, I'm not really. I'm too busy right now. But I also know Pauline, and Pauline is also connected to Angela. So I could say, oh, Pauline, will you help me? I really want Angela to do this. Maybe you could convince her. That's why triadic relations are important. We need to build these triadic relations among people. And let me give you one more example here. This is just the qualitative data that supports what I just said. This is one of the teachers who became a coach when she went back to the school. And here she is before she went through the training and became the coach. Here she is 1 year in. I feel for this teacher. And as you can see, it persists across time. Thinking, changing the infrastructure, creating a new position, creating new routines. Because it's not just about the position. It's about the position, the routines, the new curriculum. Right? It's, you know, people say, oh, you have to do coaching. Right? Oh, we have to create teacher leaders. No. Think about the various components of infrastructure and how they work together. These teacher leader positions, the PLC routines, are all anchored in a new curriculum that has a particular philosophy about teaching mathematics. You have to think about what's the infrastructure, how do the various components of the infrastructure fit together? How do they cohere? What's the vision for teaching and learning that they're anchored in? Okay, I could go on and on and on and on, but I'm sure you don't want me to go on and on and on. These slides just show that I gave you a couple of examples, but this held across all 15 schools, and there are papers that you can read about it, and you will have the data when Angela next week puts up the slides, the PDFs of the slides for you. We will not have time to do this task, but you can take it home as homework tonight. And Angela will collect it in the... I'm joking. But it's worth taking a look at. I just gave you some data from one of the schools. I actually think that given that we have 4 minutes, that I'm actually going to stop and ask you to ask me any questions or any clarifications or any issues you might have. I'm sorry for talking so much, but right now my voice is beginning to crack, so it's a good idea to take a little pause. So questions, comments, observations, worries. As I'm waiting for the first question, let me make one thing clear. Infrastructure is difficult to diagnose. Because as I said at the beginning, it's hidden, it's invisible. Only the French build buildings where the infrastructure is on the outside. This is where I'll be tomorrow evening. It's the Pompidou in Paris, in the Marais. But it's very few buildings look like this. Very few social infrastructures are public. We live within them, we take them for granted. So it's hard work to diagnose. You have to kind of almost pause and stand above it. Question, anybody?
Maybe you could...
maybe you want to take... Yes. Oh, thanks. Lifesaver.
I just want to ask about the responsibility in the context of distributed... what's the word?
Distributed
leadership.
So you're asking about the collective responsibility and how that would work within a...
need not be collective.
Okay, great. So one of the things that I get a lot of is people say, well, you know, I'm held accountable as the principal, and you want me to distribute leadership? And it's a tough one. The system, certainly in the United States, says the principal is the one ultimately responsible. And in a study, I'm working on a book based on 5 years of following two cohorts of new primary school principals, not preschools. But if Methodist bishops told me that everything I found out from the principals was very much the same that they were struggling with, I suspect preschool principals are the same. One of the biggest shocks we get when we become principals is the shock of ultimate responsibility. And all of these principles we follow, you know, I didn't get them to reflect back. I got them the summer before they got their first job, 3 months in, 1 year in, 2 years in, and then again at the end of year 4 or 5. These people were, and they all had experience as administrators. They had been assistant principals for the most part, or deputy principals. Yet they were taken aback by the ultimate responsibility shock. Sorry. And what it did to them was that they would go to involve others in the work to distribute leadership, right? And then they would say, oh, but you know, if this doesn't work out the right way, it's my head is on the line. It's I'm going to look bad. So they would report, I remember one principal says something like, I was never a micromanager. Maybe I have it up here, actually. I was never somebody who micromanaged. Yeah, here it is. That tendency to micromanage. This is Kathy. I just felt like I had to keep that in check. That was never my style before, but I think just because I would kind of get overwhelmed with the idea of responsibility. So there is this tendency, I put it down to the sense of ultimate responsibility, to pull back or to look over the deputy principal or the teacher leader's shoulder. And as I said this morning, You know, you do that for a few months, and the deputy or the teacher leader is going to say, you know what, you're wasting my time, why don't you do it yourself? Right? So I think what we have to do there is, I don't think we're going to change the policy environment in the United States, which holds the principal accountable, but I do think that we can check ourselves. We can be aware that there's this tendency, that this ultimate responsibility will pull us back even when we try and distribute leadership. The other thing, of course, that pulls us back, you know, we always think that, oh, I'm going to construct, this is how I'm going to be as a principal or as a professor, as a teacher. The reality is that people construct us into the roles of principal, assistant principal, teacher, professor, etc., by virtue of the expectations they have for us. So one of the other things we find in our work is that principals, it's this last one. This principal talks about, you know, this is the bilingual teacher leader. This is the such and such a person. But teachers still say, oh, but I want to talk to you about it, the principal. So in other words, the expectations of our staff, of the parents, may also pull us back from a distributed perspective. These are not problems we can solve. They're dilemmas that we have to manage. A dilemma, by definition, cannot be solved, but we can manage it. And half the battle in managing it, and I'm going to shut up, Angela. Well, I think I have to shut up anyway. But half the battle in managing it is being aware of it and thinking of ways then in which we might be able to, you know, the next time I'm going to look over somebody's shoulder, I'm like, oh, oh, oh. No, 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 no more. That's it. Thank you.